Thank you all for coming. It's a great pleasure, it's a great honor to welcome Professor Minxin Pei here visiting us from Claremont McKenna University, Claremont McKenna College, excuse me. For this Modern China lecture series, I want to first thank the History Department at Cal State San Bernardino, the History Club, the College of Social and Behavioral Sciences, the College of Extended Learning, the University Diversity Committee, and the California State University of San Bernardino Intellectual Life Fund, who all have made this possible. I hope you'll also join us on Friday when we'll have another talk with Professor Wang Zhehe about postmodern constructivism in China today. Professor Minxin Pei is the Tom and Margot Pritzker 1972 Professor of Government and the Director of the Keck Center for International and Strategic Studies at Claremont McKenna College. His research focuses on democratization in developing countries, economic reform, and governance in China, as well as U.S.-China relations. He's the author of several books and many, many articles. Most recently, and on sale in the back, is China's Trapped Transition, The Limits of Developmental Autocracy. He's a frequent contributor to many, many news outlets that you're familiar with, from the Financial Times, New York Times, Washington Post, Newsweek, International, and the International Herald Tribune. He's a fine scholar. It's a great pleasure for me to welcome here to Cal State San Bernardino, Dr. Minxin Pei.
Thank you very much, Professor Murray. Before I start, I want to thank Cal State San Bernardino, and in particular Professor Murray, for bringing me here today to share with you some of my observations about modern China. I know it's a very popular thing to do to title a talk The Rise and Fall. It conveys some sense of drama, some sense of suspense, or actually it also implies some morality thing. I will use a combination of images and lecture notes to illustrate the China story in the last 25 years. This year marks the 25th anniversary of the Tiananmen Square pro-democracy movement, or the crush of that movement. And the China model, the China story, is closely connected with that tragedy. Without that tragedy, China would have gone in a very, very different direction. This, again, for people who are of your age in China, they don't even know about this. Because the Chinese government has systematically wiped out references to 1989 in Chinese. Chinese young people, when they grew up in China, they don't know why. Only after they came to this country, and there are probably a few people who are in the audience who are from China. But this was May 1989 in Beijing. Roughly for 40 days, Beijing was paralyzed by mass demonstrations. It is unclear what they were demonstrating for, but it was clear that they were not happy with the government at the time. The demands were not that extravagant in terms of their political goals. They simply wanted the government to recognize the students as patriots. They wanted the government to conduct dialogue with students. And for a while, this is Tiananmen Square. As I said, more than a million, sometimes 2 million people poured into the streets. And on June 4th, the movement was crushed with unprecedented degree of violence. The government sending tanks and troops. I originally included an iconic image of one man standing in front of a row of tanks. How many of you actually have seen that image? Yeah, it is really iconic image. But in editing this, I accidentally dropped image. So this gives you an idea of what preceded the China story. The government succeeded in crushing this movement, China sank into a three-year economic and political stagnation, because after June 4th, 1989, the tragedy at Tiananmen, the conservatives came back and they stopped the reforms that were launched in the 1980s. And Deng Xiaoping, in spring 1992, Deng Xiaoping, this is the man who launched China's reforms in the 1980s, but who was also responsible for the crackdown in Tiananmen. And he came out of semi-retirement, and he made his last effort to restart China's economic reform. And this is his tour of southern China at age of almost, he died 5 years later. So at age of 87, he was pushing for China to speed up its economic reform. And after his tour of southern China, China began to open up its economy to the rest of the world very, very quickly. And then the story from there, for roughly, I would say, 15 years, was a very positive story. You see enormous dynamism. This is a group you could closely identify with. These are Chinese college students. They were working hard, studying hard for a very bright future. Same thing. And then China joined the world economy. This is a containing point. I think this is Hong Kong containing point. A huge chunk of China's foreign trade goes through Hong Kong. This is one of the world's top three containing points, because China now is a global trading power. This gives you a sense of the scale of modernization. This is a textile factory, rows after rows of. But this could easily be a furniture factory, an iPod factory, anything. But that's what made the Chinese economy grow so fast, massive manufacturing. And what drove this wave of industrialization in China is this unlimited supply of rural labor. This is a scene of at a railway station near, at the time of China's Spring Festival. This is the Chinese Lunar New Year, and traditionally people go back home because rural residents who move to cities do not actually own housing, and they do not have roots in the cities. On such occasions, they all go back home. So for about 2 weeks, the entire China, the transportation system in China is a mass scene. You have scenes like this all over the country, millions, but it's the rural labor that built modern China. I'll go through this and then I'll give you a pop lecture. Yes, it will be very hard to toggle between lecture and pictures. And China developed one of the world's most modern transportation systems. And this is China's high-speed rail. Anybody actually has ridden on that system? Now China is the world's largest system of high-speed rail. In California, former Governor Schwarzenegger tried to get the Chinese to invest in California's high-speed rail system. This can go up to 300 kilometers an hour. From Beijing to Shanghai, now it takes 5-6 hours. So it's just give you a sense of the. However, there's a dark side to China's rise. all this rapid economic growth, trade, infrastructure, is accompanied by massive environmental degradation. And this is also poverty, hidden poverty, behind China's fancy shopping malls and high-speed rail, you have actually an increase in urban poverty. And this gives you an idea of China's slums. China has done a much better job than most other developing countries in hiding slums. If you go to China, there are a lot of people who are poor, but they are not allowed to live in cities. China has a very strong government, very effective police. So if you want to put up some tents in the middle of Beijing, bad luck. They will push you out. But all you need to do is to take a cab ride 30 minutes, 45 minutes outside Beijing, and you will see things like this. Same with Shanghai. So this is poverty, and you had a very skimpy, sometimes non-existent social safety nets. Social safety provisions cover only about 35% of China's urban population, not rural population. So if you're old, bad luck. There were stories of very old people who do not enjoy any pension protection, health care. So as a result, they committed some small crimes and they say, my gosh, jail is a wonderful place to be because you get fed, you have health care, you have housing, and all of that is for free. So this is, you see a lot of begging. And this is probably the danger that is going to threaten China's future more than any other dangers, environmental degradation. This is garbage, it was chemical discharge. I don't know what she's doing. Probably she's either washing laundry or washing dishes or washing vegetables. I wouldn't do any of those things in the water that you see. And now this is, you can see the iconic building, the Shanghai TV Tower. This is from a taller building. You say, my gosh, how romantic. The entire city is covered with cloud. No, it's not cloud, it's smog. You cannot see. And this is, again, gives you an idea of environmental degradation. And this is Beijing. This is Shanghai. This is Beijing. This is actually, architecturally speaking, that's one of the revolutionary buildings in architecture history. It's enormously challenging to build. Anybody here who's an architect, who's studying to be an architect? Because when you look at the physics, it is truly amazing. It's how, unfortunately, houses China's CCTV, central government TV, and it's a propaganda department. But you cannot see the rest of the region. And also, social unrest has grown tremendously. This is a scene, this is ethnic conflict. In the 1980s, China was fairly peaceful in terms of its ethnic relations. But in the last 10 years, ethnic conflict in two parts of China, Tibet and Xinjiang, became very, very intense. And this was a scene in 2010, July, when one minority group called the Uyghurs, it's a Muslim Turkic speaking minority in Xinjiang, attacked Huns. And then the Han Chinese, these are Han Chinese, organized vigilantes to fight back. So this is the scene. But in China proper, this is the area where 92% of the Chinese population live. Han Chinese people look like me. Social protest riots have also increased. This was a scene, I forgot it, probably 2008, in Anhui, in the town where they were, there was a riot against the police. They were burning the police station. This is from the same scene. So just massive crowds. And also corruption. This is, because I'm talking about the dark side of China's rise, inequality, poverty, lack of social safety net, and social conflict, and this is corruption. Why do I shoot this and say, my gosh, what is Capitol Hill doing in China, right? This is actually the building of a local Chinese government office. And you can find these everywhere in China. There are several ironies about such buildings. The one that I'm struck most by is that if you know anything about the Chinese Communist Party, the thing it hates most is democracy. But why would they they hate democracy on the one side, but they copy democratic symbols, they steal the architectural styles of democratic buildings, right? You know, buildings symbolizing democracy. So this is one. And another is, again, a little local government office. This is abuse of power. And this, of course, a former very senior Chinese official. He was ranked among the top 25 of the Communist Party's senior leaders. He was sentenced to life imprisonment not too long ago for corruption. His wife was convicted or pleaded guilty for killing this British national, and that's his police chief. When he was the party chief of a major city, he used his police chief to arrest private entrepreneurs, innocent citizens. When they arrested private entrepreneurs, they took away all their assets. In fact, the guy behaved no differently than a mafioso boss when he was governing China. And today, China is governed by these seven people. And the question is, are they going to govern China? Are they going to avoid making huge mistakes? Can they continue to sustain China's story? So this is now a very quick slideshow to give you some context of the story of China's rise. And then you can also see the danger that China faces in the years ahead. China in the 1980s was a very different country because the China model didn't exist in the 1980s. The 1980s, China had a decade of experimentation, of exploring for various possibilities. And China did not begin to move in the direction of the so-called China model until the early 1990s, when Deng Xiaoping launched a new round of economic reform. In the 1980s, China was a far more healthy country, even though it was a lot poorer than it is today. Because in the 1980s, the economy was more balanced, and on the political front, the leadership was actually interested in loosening up the political system, embracing some democratic changes, and economically, they began to roll back the state systematically. So the 1980s, in retrospect, if the trends in the 1980s had continued, China would have been a very different country today. But China was not, but that trend, those trends ended in 1989. So starting in the 1990s, China began to move in a very, very different direction. This is what I call the China model. So what is the essence of the China model? In the 1980s, there was a big debate in China. The debate touches on four issues. Economically, there were two issues. Whether China should completely embrace capitalism, to whether China should completely reject socialism. And that debate was inconclusive. And Deng Xiaoping was in favor of embracing capitalism and rejecting communism. But he met very strong resistance from the conservatives who said China should reject capitalism. So in the 1980s, China had this debate for about a decade. The debate was inconclusive until Tiananmen came along, and I'll continue that story later. The other two issues dealt with the second big question. What should China do politically? One issue is whether China should embrace democracy. And the second one is, should China continue to embrace authoritarian rule or one-party dictatorship? And again, on this issue, China, within the Chinese Communist Party, there was no consensus. Why these four issues regarding two essential questions were resolved in 1989 forced Deng Xiaoping to make a fateful choice. Deng Xiaoping himself was a complicated person. Economically, he liked capitalism. He studied in France when he was a young man. He visited the U.S. He was so impressed by the U.S., by the dynamism of capitalism that he said China could not become a wealthy country without capitalism. But he was also politically very conservative. He said China could not become capitalism with democracy. China could have capitalism, but not capitalism plus democracy. So throughout the 80s, he would fight back at efforts that were trying to, he would crush pro-democracy movement because he thought democracy would be bad for capitalism. So in 1989, the situation in 1989 forced him to pick one choice. So he came down very hard on the students, but he also told his conservative colleagues that China's future lies in economic reform. Because in 1989, you all know what happened in the former Soviet Union. Communism collapsed. And the Soviet Union, of course, disintegrated in 1991. So in early 1992, Deng Xiaoping managed to persuade his colleagues to come to a consensus that China should have capitalism, but not democracy. And as a result, the last 25 years, China had this historical experiment on a grand scale, capitalism without democracy. We call this authoritarian capitalism or new authoritarianism in China. As a result, in the last 25 years, China opened its doors to foreign direct investment. In the 1980s, China had total foreign direct investment of something less than $10 billion. But in the last 25 years, China had direct investment from foreign countries in excess of $1 trillion. So, in other words, 99% of all foreign direct investment came in the last 25 years. Now, so China as a result became a very integrated economy with the rest of the world. And also, China began to encourage private sector entrepreneurs, and China began to also privatize some of the state-owned enterprises. So the economy became much more diverse, not a state-dominated economy. The number was, in the early, in 1989, the state-owned portion of the economy was still something like 80%. But today, the portion is about 35%. Still, it's a huge chunk. And China also embarked in this period on a massive infrastructure building plan. And this plan, of course, you saw in the pictures. This made China a developing country with first world infrastructure. I think for Americans who have visited China, one of the things they are impressed most is the new airports. If you leave from LAX and landed in Beijing or in Shanghai, you'll say, did I leave a third world country and arrive in a first world country? So LAX is really horrible. Yep, I think I don't need to tell this audience it's sometimes you're lucky to get a seat. But if you go to China, all airports are very nice, roads are nice. That's all part of this program. And the result of this economic development, this market-driven economic development for the last 25 years, is that China became the world's second largest economy. In the last 25 years, the Chinese economy grew at roughly 10% a year for 25 years. And just to give you some idea what that has done to the rest of the world and to China. In 1992, the Chinese economy was 6% of the US economy. Then in 2000, the Chinese economy was something like 16% of the US economy. So it's already more than double in terms of its revenue. Then 2008, the Chinese economy was 36%. Today, the Chinese economy is roughly 60% of the US economy. So within 22 years, the Chinese economy, the relative size of the Chinese economy to the US has increased 1,000%. So as a result, China has produced enormous waves. I think a lot of you were born in the early 90s. In the early 90s, actually, it's pretty hard to find things made in China. And today, it is very hard to find things not made in China. If you just look around, iPhones and so. But this is all because of China's economic growth and the nature of that economic growth. China's economic growth was very closely connected with global trade. In 1992, probably China's exports amounted to no more than 2% of global exports. Today it's 12%. And that China now exports more in terms of volume, not in terms of value, more than any other country in the world. And soon China was, even though the US imports more, the US is now the world's largest trading power, China is the second largest trading power. If the current trend continues within 5-10 years, China will be the world's biggest trading power. So if you look at many, many numbers, this is the rise of the China market. Now, we, of course, can go into all kinds of details, but we can do that in Q&A. But let me briefly summarize why the China model worked for roughly 15 years. I can date the collapse of the China model. The beginning of the fall of the China market. One was that the first half of the China market, in the 1990s, China adopted good policies, liberalizing the economy, allowing private entrepreneurs to get into all kinds of economic activities, embracing globalization, especially foreign investment and foreign trade. And also encouraging competition between private sector and the state sector, and encouraging competition between different Chinese regions. Because China has 31 provinces, plus Macau and Hong Kong. These are very large jurisdictions. The biggest Chinese province, Henan province, and Sichuan, these two big provinces, each of them has population of more than 100 million people. Even medium-sized province in China has more population than California. So competition among these provinces increases economic efficiency. So this is some of the policies adopted in the 1990s were the right policies. So that's one. The second one was that timing was perfect for China. For anybody who has achieved some success, luck always has played a very important role. If you talk to Bill Gates, if you talk to Warren Buffett, the two iconic, successful business people, you say, how come you're so successful? They say, I'm so lucky. Yes, had Bill Gates dropped out of Harvard today, and he still had this idea about Microsoft, probably would not have made him that successful, right? Because timing was not good. So for China, the 1990s was perfect timing because it was end of the Cold War. The world was becoming closely connected, globalization. In the 1980s, the 1970s, trade barrier in the world was very high. So China could tap into enormous markets around the world. Poor countries face many obstacles in economic development. And one of them is demand, because poor countries cannot consume. So economic growth is driven by demand growth. So if you are poor, if you are in a poor country, if you produce cool gadgets, if nobody buys your cool gadgets, you're going to stay poor. So the trick is to get somebody who have the money to buy the gadgets. Before globalization, China could not find customers in Saint-Bernardino, right? Today, China does not need to find customers. China already has customers, and that's because of globalization. So the timing was good. Globalization. In specific terms, foreign capital was looking for places with cheap labor, because labor was becoming very expensive in the US, in Western Europe, in Japan, and China had an abundance of cheap labor, especially in the countryside. So that's one, perfect timing. Second was that the Chinese people were very optimistic in the early 1990s. I don't have the pictures, but I can give you this image of China in the early 1990s. This is from a friend of mine. He went back to China. He did an investment. He gave me two pictures to think about. He said, in the early 1990s, when he went to China, he saw rural migrants going from villages to big cities in open cattle cars, because trains were so crowded they could not get seats, but they still wanted to go to cities to make the China dream come true. So they would go, they would leave the children behind, they would leave everything behind and go to cities and become a migrant laborer, working construction site, working in those factories, because they would be making a lot more. So really hard work, that the entrepreneurship, the work ethic of the Chinese people. If you know anything about Chinese society and Chinese people, you know that this is a nation that does not have a formal religion. China, the biggest difference between China and the rest of the world is the lack of a religion. Confucianism is not a religion. Confucianism is a doctrine. Buddhism is not a national religion. And Buddhism is very different from Christianity. But China, most Chinese people at least, do have a god, and the god is money. So money making, if you see China, Chinese people all over the world, you'll find them so hardworking. They're driven by this quasi-religious force to succeed in this world. They don't have another world, so they want to be successful in this world. So the same urge drove 1.3 billion people in the 1990s for this enormous time. Made unleashed by economic opportunities. The other picture, let me just conclude that part of the story. But today, my friend said, if you go to Chinese villages, what do you see? You see young people playing with their iPhones, playing in internet cafes, playing video games, playing computer games. That's a very, very different generation from us 20 years ago. And China got extremely lucky at the time that China had the last 20 years was a period in which China had a very favorable demographic profile. What I mean by this phrase is that China had a lot of young people and relatively fewer old people on retirement, on pensions. When you have young people, you do not have to pay a lot for their health care, for their retirement. So you can have higher rates of savings, which can be used to finance investments, factories, power plants, and infrastructure. And if you look at the growth of the Chinese economy, it is primarily driven by investments. China's investments for the last 25 years average 40% per year. So you say, what about that rate of investment? To give you some idea, the US investment rate is about 20% per year. So the US invests half as much as China. And the economy grows with three things. If you have an increase of population that brings in more labor, it grows. But that kind of growth is very limited because you cannot grow. Population growth is no more than 1% a year. The second is that you have to have more capital, more investments. So that's, and that part, China is growing a lot bigger, double the US size. And the third part is productivity increase, technological innovation. This part of the US is always at the leading edge. So, but if you look at the two of the three components of economic growth, labor, Chinese labor force was growing fast, and investment. So the China model actually is very simple. You follow market principles, the timing was perfect, you had cheap, healthy, well-educated labor force, and it had enough domestic savings and foreign direct investment to drive economic growth. However, I would say the Chinese economic miracle or the China model is now over. I'm not going to say it has already fallen. I think the beginning of the fall has already occurred. Because behind these impressive numbers, there is a dark side. Not all economic growth is good. Economic growth always has costs. In a healthier society, the costs and benefits are more or less balanced. In a less healthy society, the benefits go to a relatively small group of people, and most of the costs are shared by the majority of the people. And we see this in China as well. How are these costs shared in China, social costs? The most obvious example is environmental degradation, because the Chinese government made a very conscious decision. They were rather a misguided decision. They think that it is cheaper to grow in a very polluting way. They think that they can always wait when they are wealthy and they clean up the environment. They've not learned anything from history. What history tells everybody is that it's always more expensive to clean up, right? Just give you a simple image. If you pour some dirty chemical into your backyard, it would take a lot of money to clean up that chemical, right? So this is, and China today, as a nation, is facing ecological disaster. Every year, we're talking about at least a million, if not a million, 1 point, if not a million and a half people die of air pollution. Water pollution, mainly through chemically polluted water, water waste. Water pollution kills another 700,000 people. So every year, probably 2 million people dies of pollution. And then water is becoming very scarce, especially in the north. Two-thirds of the waterway is polluted. Groundwater in all the cities is polluted. And China lacks a lot of water. China is one of the driest countries in the world. If you think Southern California is desert, so probably Southern California has more water per capita than most of China. So China faces air pollution and water pollution crisis. And also socially, inequality has risen to a very high level. Based on how you calculate, China today probably is among the top five most unequal nations on Earth. China used to be a very equal nation. When I left China in 1984, the measure we use to measure in income inequality in China was something like 0.3 of the Gini coefficient. Today, China's Gini coefficient is around 5, anywhere between, estimates between 4.5 and 5. That would place China among some of the worst nations in terms of income inequality. And also corruption has become a genuinely very serious problem. Because I'm not saying that there was no corruption in China in the 1980s, but today corruption is very different. The person whose picture I show, he actually should be considered relatively clean because when he was put on trial, he was accused of pocketing something like $5 million. And for a senior official of that rank, the popular reaction in China is that the guy should be given a medal because it's so little. Now they're prosecuting, investigating corruption cases. We're talking about hundreds of millions of dollars. The Chinese premier who just stepped down last year, his family acquired $1.7 billion in wealth. So this crony capitalism in China over the last 20 years has now become a systemic problem for China. And as a result, you have very high levels of social discontent. Because people, average people in China today sees the following things. They hear, they know about official corruption. A small group of very privileged government officials and their children becoming very rich very quickly. Second, they know their living environment is becoming less tolerable because of corruption. And third, social mobility in China is declining because nowadays, if you want to get a good job, you need connections. And fourth, things they care a lot about, the government is failing to provide, especially for middle-class people. So middle-class people care a lot about housing prices. Housing prices in China are very high. Healthcare quality, access of healthcare, not satisfactory. And also social safety, retirement. Because China is going to become an aging society very soon. China today has the same demographic profile as Japan 20 years ago. So think about Japan. Anybody been to Japan? Yeah, so what did Japan impress you upon other than its good food?
From Okinawa.
I'm sorry, okay.
But I've never been to mainland.
The mainland, okay. It says you find a lot of old people. About 20% of Japanese society is 60 and above. In 20 years, Chinese society will be 60 and above. But Japan is a very wealthy society. 20 years ago, Japan was a very wealthy society. China today is still a developing country. So the challenge for China is much more daunting than for Japan. So you have a confluence of negative trends converging in China. Demographic, the disappearance of the demographic dividend. You have also corruption, you have social frustrations, and you have environmental degradation. So the future for China for the next 10 years will be a much more challenging than for the last 25 years. The question is, can the Communist Party maintain stability? So remember the job the seven people who actually govern China face in the coming decade. My own prediction is that it will be very close call whether they're going to keep China's stability and economic prosperity going for two reasons. One is that China's rapid economic growth is over. When you look ahead, it will be inconceivable that China can maintain anything above 7% of economic growth, because this simply does not happen. feel affecting loss of competitiveness, constraints on resources, constraints from the environment, labor shortages. China's economic growth, China would be very lucky to obtain 7% economic growth for the next 10 years. So the question is, what happens if economic growth slows down? In the short term, the mainstream view on Chinese economy is that if economic growth slows down, China could have a financial crisis. Because over the last 10 years, China has borrowed a lot of money to finance its real estate boom and its infrastructure boom. So China today has a lot of ghost cities. They build many housing units that are simply not inhabited. People use these units, housing units, mostly apartments. They don't have a lot of single family housing. They use them as investments. I think for people who live in San Bernardino, you are very familiar with the concept of the housing bubble. We had one in this part of the world 5 or 6 years ago. But in China, you go there, you see just towns, entire cities, empty rows after rows of empty apartment buildings. So if economic growth slows down, China could face a financial crisis. Another danger is that for a people who have become accustomed to 10% growth, if growth rate falls to 7%, the difference can actually be huge because income will rise at a much slower level, there will be a lot fewer jobs, so there's worry that there can be an increase in social unrest. And third is that within the Chinese government, if you have less economic growth, it also means there's much less to steal, there's much less to distribute among the ruling elites. So there will be more tensions within the ruling elites. So the result from low economic growth for the next 3 to 5 years is that the probability of some kind of instability or crisis is much higher. But looking ahead at long term, the Chinese Communist Party will be even more worried because of two issues. One is that throughout the world, one party regimes or authoritarian regimes, we're talking about non-democratic forms of government, find it very hard to maintain their forms of government if society becomes very wealthy. Above the level of, say, $10,000 per capita income, China today is about $7,000. You find probably no more than 2 or 3 countries that are not oil-based economies that can maintain one-party rule or non-democratic forms of government. And China is already 7,000, so even at 4%, 3% growth, within 15 years, China will hit that level. And that will produce profound political effects, which might lead to the fall of a one-party state. So the Chinese government is extremely worried about that possibility. That what political scientists call this political modernization. The other issue that the Chinese Communist Party is very aware of is this longevity rule for one-party regimes. One-party dictatorships are among the most sophisticated, well-developed non-democratic forms of government in the world. But even for this kind of regimes, the historical record of longevity is about 74 years. You know, if for one reason or another, these regimes don't live beyond mid-70s, just like a human being. So the Chinese Communist Party has been in power for 65 years. So it probably has another 10 years and then it will be in the danger zone. It will be like, shall we say, a senior citizen. So they are looking ahead and they are aware of history, they are aware of the fact that most wealthy countries are democratic. So if I were in Beijing, if I were in their shoes, I would actually think about the end game for this system. Whether they want to have a soft political landing, opening up the political system, just like Mexico, Taiwan, or Brazil, and then create a different China miracle, China's political miracle. Because if China can make peaceful and gradual transition from one party rule to democratic rule in the next 10 years, that will be a true miracle. And then I would say you're going to have the real China model. That is, the real China model is capitalism plus democracy. So I think I will stop here and then take questions. Thank you. Yes.
I have two questions.
Yes.
Firstly, I know that the Chinese dream is really a hot topic in China
yes.
right now, and also the new government
yes.
Is testing some new economy as a movement,
yes.
like launching the Shanghai Free Zone.
Yes.
Shanghai Free Zone.
Yeah.
Yeah. My question is how this new movement you think will affect the China model in the next 20 years?
Yeah, excellent question. Thank you. China has a leadership change in November 2012. And as a result, they produced seven people in the Communist Party's Politburo Standing Committee. And the strategy of this new group is twofold. One, they're going to resist political change, resist democratic change. So they crack down very hard on social media, on civil society, on the one hand. And on the other hand, they want to clean up the Communist Party. So there's an anti-corruption movement going on, campaign going on. At the same time, of course, they fight corruption but promote economic change. Is that they, in other words, they want to do more of the same, minus the corruption, because they believe that the one-party system can be maintained, but it can only be maintained with a more efficient economy. So the biggest question we have about this strategy is that will it succeed? That can a one-party system have an efficient economy without bringing in popular participation? Because if you bring in popular participation, then you have democracy, so they don't want it. At the moment, because about 6 months ago, this new leadership proposed very ambitious reform programs. So far, not much has happened. So we're still waiting. My personal observation is that it is most likely that they will fail. Because at the moment, nearly all economic reforms will require that the ruling elites, we're talking about the Communist Party, 86 million people, 7% of the population. Not all of them are among the top elites. So probably we're talking about 10, 15 million people who have done very well as part of the ruling elites. We are asking them to give up their privileges. We are asking them to be less greedy. We are asking them to give up their power to society, to private entrepreneurs. Let market forces determine who is a winner, who is a loser. So this is the goal, this is the Chinese dream. We are asking them to sacrifice a lot. So the question is, are they going to sacrifice a lot without any political pressure, right? At the moment was, China's future will be bright if you can only be less greedy, if you can only give up your power. I think it's a very tough sell to this group, because based on what we know about human history, is that ruling elites will give up power, privileges, only when they have no other alternative. So right now, we have the current leadership is not calling upon the people, using the power of the people to force the ruling elites to give up their power. So I'm extremely skeptical. But we'll say, if we want to render a final verdict, we'll wait another 5-6 months and see whether Shanghai Free Trade Zone is going anywhere. I think I'm from Shanghai, I don't think it's going anywhere. Because China does not need free trade zones. China needs another round of economic revolution. And that revolution will entail complete privatization of state-owned enterprises, complete liberalization, and actually have genuine rule of law to constrain the power of the state. Yes.
Assuming that the Communist Party is reluctant to give up its power, assuming the economy goes down a little bit, assuming social unrest escalates in the next 5 to 10 years, are we talking about the possibility of some kind of violent revolution in store for China?
Yeah. Well, I would say that it's going to be a tough call. Because when you look at Tiananmen, it was almost a violent. It was almost a revolution. The revolution almost succeeded. The most likely scenario is that if you have a period of economic poor performance, social frustrations and unrest, what it will do is there will be more social unrest. But social unrest alone will not be enough to overthrow the Chinese government. The Chinese government is a very powerful government. It will make Mubarak's Egypt, if you are familiar with the Arab Spring, look like an amateur. Because the Chinese government, let me just give you the number, 2.5 million soldiers, about 1 million armed police, then 2 or 3 million policemen. It's a very powerful state. So if you have an uprising on the part of the population like the Arab Spring, if the government remains unified, there will be no revolution. There will be another Tiananmen and will be crushed. But things are more complicated. When you have a poor performing economy, social unrest, the most likely scenario is that the seven people, they're going to start fighting each other. They're going to say, who is going to be responsible for this? Because that creates opportunity. Bad conditions create opportunities for some to be top, to become the new leader. So they would engage in an internal fighting, which then will do two things. One is to send a signal to society that leadership is not unified. The chances of success of a popular movement have improved. So that's one. So there will be more social unrest, more protests. But there's another signal that will be sent out to China's police force, the military. The leadership is not unified. So do not go out and shoot. So the leadership, the police, the Chinese state will be reacting much more slowly. So if that happens, then the conditions for revolution will be a lot more favorable.
I don't want to monopolize.
Oh,
I do have one more question. So currently, from what I've seen in the media, Xi Jinping is doing all kinds of things, and they kind of talk about building town and
yes.
blah, blah, blah. So and one view has it that their aim is the big tiger, Jiang Zemin.
Yeah.
Do you think Jiang Zemin will eventually be put on a stage to be the bad guy?
No, I think, because if, okay, for those who are following the Chinese domestic developments closely, it is a political drama much more interesting and riveting than the House of Cards. Because here you have involvement of the mafia, real involvement of the mafia in the Chinese drama. So you should send an email to the creator of House of Cards. What about a few mafios? What about House of Cards plus Soprano, right? We'll make it far more interesting. What's going on in China is that the equivalent of the domestic security chief in China stepped down. And his family was involved with the mafia. His family, again, based on rumors, has accumulated something like $16 billion. $16 billion, not $16 million. $16 billion in wealth. This is really looting on a grand scale. And he's been arrested. It's almost certain he's going to be put on trial. China, the Communist Party has a rule. The rule is that so far, for the last 20 years, it has several ranks. If you are among the top 7 or 9 people, they call it Politburo Standing Committee. If you are a member of that committee or a retired member of that committee, you are essentially above law. Nobody can touch you. Even if you commit murder, nobody is going to come after you. I equate this law, I think the law, this rule is equivalent to the mafia. You know about the mafia rule? You don't kill godfathers, right? If you do not kill the head of the other families. But this time, the new leader is very tough. He is going after that guy. So that guy is going to fall. But the biggest question is that will he be the last one? Because there are a lot of very senior corrupt officials at that level. So if you go after one, are you going to go after the others? And this gentleman's question is that there is this retired party chief. We're not talking about just a member of the standing committee. We're talking about party chief. And he may not be clean. Will he be brought down? My own view on this is that very unlikely. Because the guy is 87, 88. Give him another 2 or 3 years. And nature will take its course, right? So why not? Why create another political risk for this new leader? The new leader may be tough, but he also very strategic.
All right, thank you.
Yes.
Continuing on Ron's
yes.
point, also about the new left and
yes.
Bo Xilai,
yes.
Who is the figure that we saw there, and Zhou Yongkang.
Zhou Yongkang.
Do you feel that going after the, if this is going after the new left, going after the new left in this way is going to show the government's ability to protect itself or maybe lead to a resurgence in the new left or some kind of revitalization?
Yeah. First, some explanation about the concept of the new left. If you are taking Professor Murray's class, maybe you're very familiar. For those who are not his students, let me just explain this very quickly. In the last 10 years, there was this strange group, mostly intellectuals, who think they are new Marxists. They have a critique of pro-capitalist economic development policies. And we call them the new left. And they think Mao, the late dictator, Mao Zedong, was unjustly criticized. So they want to bring back some of the symbols and policies of Chairman Mao. This group was closely connected with Bo Xilai, the Politburo member who was in handcuffs and who is now spending his time reflecting his personal life in the jail, in the jail cell. And so they were deeply connected. But after Mr. Bo fell from power, this group lost influence. Interestingly, the new leadership has not gone after that group. Some of their publications have been closed down, some of their websites have been closed, but none of their representatives have been arrested. On the other hand, pro-democracy leaders, civic leaders, have been arrested in San Francisco. So my guess is that the new leadership consists of some very conservative elements who actually are protecting the UN. But the new leadership is also aware of the danger of embracing neo-Maoists or neo-Marxists, because embracing these people will be ideologically inconvenient when their biggest priority is another round of pro-capitalist development. So at the moment, it's quite unclear, but I think in their heart, they just do not want the new left to complicate their lives. Yes?
I remember you made suggestion for the Chinese government to make a chance to like open the political system.
Yes.
To move to the democracy.
Yes.
But right now, just like Taiwan.
Yes.
But right now, Taiwan also is experiencing some
yes.
movement.
Yes.
Even is under the democracy.
Yes.
So, in your opinion, what Chinese government should learn from this lesson?
Well, Taiwan is a remarkable success story in terms of democratic development. Anybody been to Taiwan?
I've been
several times. It's a textbook example of how a country can become rich and democratic. It's transition from a dictatorship, which governed Taiwan from 1947 to 1945 to about 1986, when they allowed opposition parties to emerge. In the transition, not a person died. The completely peaceful. Several two turnovers
of power from opposition to from government to the opposition and then back.
And despite the recent occupation of the parliament by students, no violence was used. Students withdrew. The demand was met. So I would not say that Taiwan's democracy has failed. There's one democracy that's failed. That's Thailand. Thailand, because it had really chaotic situation, had the military coming in. But in Taiwan, everything has been resolved peacefully. And most of the time, they resolve their disputes constitutionally. So for China, I would say, learn a lesson from Taiwan. The lesson I learned from Taiwan is that if a dictatorship wants to transform itself into a non-dictatorship, gradually, peacefully, and over time, and ensure its political viability after the transformation, it should start as soon as possible. Because the sooner you start, the more hope the population have about the future. So you avoid polarization in society, you avoid radicalism in society, and also by introducing competitive politics, you force the ruling party to adapt. Because in Taiwan, the government allowed local elections very early on, 1950s, 60s. So even though at the national level there was no democracy, the ruling party had constantly to compete with other social forces for local offices. And they had to raise money, they had to organize the voters,
they have to put up attractive candidates, so they actually learn something. And gradually, they learn how to deal with democratic forces. So for China, I would say, the sooner you start the process, the better off you're going to be.
I also don't want to monopolize the time, but I'd like to hear Professor Pei, your thoughts on, as we approach, you mentioned the 25th anniversary
yes.
of the June protests in 1989. What do you think the awareness is and do you think there are going to be any kind of protests in China? Do you think the government is thinking about this, is wary of this? And then on a separate issue, do you think that the government is thinking about drawing lessons from 1989 and moving forward in a different way?
I don't think there will be protests in China, inside China, this year to mark the anniversary. Because June 4th is a sensitive term. If you're in China around June 4th, you're typing the Chinese word June 4th, it will be blocked. Text messages will not be sent with it. Because the Chinese government will tighten political control around that anniversary. So the country was, the country is likely to be locked down. So you will have more patrol, more internet, police patrol. So that part possibility does not exist. Outside China in Hong Kong, probably this year, going to have a big demonstration to commemorate June 4th. But the Chinese government doesn't care that much. As far as lessons from June 4th are concerned, so far the government has learned only one set of lessons about how to prevent another June 4th. First lesson, A, you have to nip the crisis in the bud. That is, you have to react very fast. The first sign of trouble, you shock and awe. That is, you deploy overwhelming police force to crush it. I have to say it's a very smart move. So this is one. And second one is that you use the right force to do the crushing. In June 4th, China for some reason did not use anti-riot force. And they used the kind of force that is least suitable for dealing with protests. They use the military. Anybody did any military training? Military training, you actually, the soldiers are trained to kill. Very different. Police, anti-riot, you're trained to disperse crowds. And the military training is that you go in, you want to encircle and you annihilate. You just kill everybody. That's what they did in Tiananmen, because they blocked the square, they did not allow people to leave for a while. The people actually who were killed around the square, in the approach to the square. So they learned the lesson, is that in the last 25 years, they trained, invested in anti-riot police. So they have very well trained anti-riot police. So this time, it crushed ahead of time or crush in time, and they use the right force. They have, now they have gas, they have tear gas canisters. In 1989, they did not even have tear gas canisters. If you look at the pictures, what you see is that how poorly equipped the Chinese state was. Today, if you just Google riots in China, and you will see anti-riot police, very well equipped. So this is the whatever technical lessons they've learned. The problem is that these are the right technical lessons, but the wrong strategic lessons. The strategic lesson was to learn, one should learn from Tiananmen, is that you really have to address the political demands of the majority of the Chinese people. Because today, if you're an average Chinese citizen, and if your house has been taken away, if you lose your land, or if you have been beaten by a government official, you have no recourse. This is, you go to court, you can go to the court, they ask you to go and take a walk. If you go to the government office, they ignore you. So how can ordinary people get justice done in China? So as long as you do not have a system that addresses popular grievances, issues of social injustice, then this kind of protest is going to occur. And in fact, China today has about on average 500 protests a day. China has about 200,000 riots every day, except they are not happening in major cities. They're happening in smaller towns. But at some point, this is like having a lot of small fires in this neighborhood. At some point, these small fires might connect and you have a huge fire, and that can be another camera.
So continue on that. The possibility of connecting was another thing I was wondering about. There's so many small protests, and anybody who's been in a small Chinese village might have seen them, and I have seen these in Hainan, these small village protests.
Yeah.
One thing it seems the government is especially skillful at is keeping these separate, as you say. Is there a possibility of these coming together, whether it's around a figure, around a popular figure? It seems there are some figures that are very popular in Western media, but their names are effectively suppressed in Chinese media. These kind of figureheads don't seem to be connecting factors. Are there any potential connecting factors that you see, whether it's related to labor, pollution, or that kind of thing?
The most likely would be two issues. One would be environment. All of a sudden, well, right now, a city in northern China has no running water because of a chemical spill. So no running water for days. Suppose this happens in Beijing or in Shanghai, in a major city, and that could be a connecting factor. Or food safety scale, because China's arable land has been contaminated with heavy metals. The government does not release figures. You don't have testing of rice, food. So what if there's this rumor that all the rice is heavy metal and nobody would be buying rice? And that would affect very large cities, many of them at the same time. So these two scare, not necessarily air pollution, because air pollution, people stay indoors. water pollution, they can go out. So these two. And the second likelihood would be financial crisis. I think 2 weeks ago, there's this small town in Jiangsu province. They had a bank loan, run on the banks, because there were rumors that this little bank is going to go bankrupt. So hundreds and thousands of people lined up in front of the bank to get their money back. Because in China, there are lots of small banks, lots of quasi-bank institutions, such as trust companies, and they take money from ordinary people. And they are very risky, not the largest banks. So if some of these institutions are rumored to be going down, and then you have lots of depositors lining up to demand their money back, and then if the police mishandle this, you could have a huge explosion of ordinary people, middle-class people. The possibilities are limitless.
I have one last question.
Please.
If anybody else has any questions, then make sure we get them in. And that is as a historian to a political scientist and thinking about models and exceptionalism. The American people and the Chinese people both have a very strong idea of their own exceptionalism.
Yes.
But when it comes to exceptionalism in terms of political models and economic models, we also do see some breaking of the rules and defying the odds,
yeah,
and this kind of thing, especially in the last 30 years in China. You talk about models, but to what extent does China also make its own models, make its own rules, and prove very durable and sometimes even nimble in the way that it deals with certain things? Do you think that there's a possibility of reinvention almost indefinitely?
Yeah, I would say the model China, the Communist Party of China has pioneered is constant refinement of repressive techniques. If you're familiar with the Toyota model, Toyota has pioneered constant improvement. That's why Toyota cars are so good, because they always tweak, refine little things. And this is what the Chinese government has done for the Toyota model, is to constantly look for the most effective ways of repression, of containing popular anger. And I'm giving you some very innovative examples. Leaving aside the issue of technology. Technology, it's a matter of money, but it's not necessarily political ingenuity. So in China, the political ingenuity, if they want to make sure that there is no social protest, local officials would do things you cannot even imagine. They would go to they will go to the families of protesters and say, if your family member joins the protest, you're going to lose your job. Your kid is going to lose his slot in the school. He's not going to have a slot. And they apply this. So they would, you try to exploit human weaknesses. Exploit your loyalty to friends, loyalty to family members. So they, and this kind of thing is completely unheard of. So, another example is, they want to control college campuses. So they would encourage students to spy on their professors. So if a professor like me lectures in a way that encourages dissident thinking, then students in the audience would go write a little report. That way they get some stipend, but also they are insured a better job when they graduate. So this is probably, I would say, the Chinese next North Korea simply uses brute force. It is repression, it's brutal repression. The Chinese repression is smart repression. And that, I actually have worries about. That is, a regime that uses smart repression may actually succeed. Because human beings are human beings. So if you're cynical enough, if you're ruthless enough, and if you're smart enough, then probably they can stay non-democratic for another 30, 40 years.
Thank you very much, Professor Pei.
Thank you.